Hello and welcome to the fifth and final video looking at the use of assessment objectives in AS and A2 English literature. In this particular video, we're going to be looking at the use of assessment objective 4. AO4 focuses on the contexts or the time and place when particular texts were written. It looks at the ideas that went to inform and create those texts and how those texts were then received, understood, interpreted, or criticised over time. AO4 has two particular areas of assessment focus. The first one is asking you to show your understanding of how and why the time or the era that the text was created in relates to its creation. So when the text was written, how did the social, political, and economic circumstances surrounding the writer influence the way that they wrote that particular text? So in part, it has a lot to do with understanding the history of the text and when it was written. The second area asks you to then look and see how different times after the text was written have interpreted and evaluated those texts. So in a sense, it fits in with AO2 and AO3, where we look at other readings of that particular text to understand why it's been received the way it has at a particular moment in its history. AO4 appears mainly in coursework, but there are elements of it in examinations, particularly synoptic elements, and in the OCR examination, you are actually asked to answer general questions that compare texts, but also look at their contexts. So AO3 and AO4 are together in that examination. The examiners focus on three major areas of concern when candidates are answering questions based on AO4. First one is ignorance and anachronism. Anachronism is when you put modern era ideas or thoughts or circumstances into the past and judge the past as if it was the present, which is often a misconception within candidates' understanding. The second part is assertions and generalizations, where people just make comments and don't back them up, or make general comments about a particular time. And thirdly, as in with AO2 or AO3, relevance. They don't really link the context to what they're writing about or the question. So then, it's looking at the problem of ignorance and anachronism. Ignorance basically means you haven't done the reading, and that means you cannot answer an AO4 question competently enough. That means it's important to read around your text, understand the time when it was written, understand what writers and critics and other artists or important people were saying about that particular text at the time, and how it links to the ideas, the spiritual ideas, the social ideas, the political ideas, and even maybe the economic ideas of its particular time of production. And then, of course, the anachronism here, where candidates confuse past with the present and mix things up. So a number of examiners' reports often humorously refer to the fact of people mentioning that there were televisions or radio in the time of Dickens or electricity in the time of Shakespeare. That shows you have really not got a very good understanding. And so the understanding of the period, a simple one, one that you may even get off Wikipedia, which is not recommended, but you should be able to at least get a grasp of a particular period, needs to be shown. An examiner is alerted to a lack of understanding in AO4, and also it subverts any ability to contrast texts if a student makes simple historical errors and does not really show a good background understanding of the particular time a text was written. And this is true even of more recent texts that maybe have been written in the 20th century, such as the 1960s or 70s, the poems of Philip Larkin, for example. The next area where examiners identify weaknesses in students' responses to AO4 are assertions and generalizations, and these link also to confusion and lack of knowledge. So often in exam answers or essay responses, statements are made and they're vaguely linked to a text. So for example, talking about Shakespeare, you might say, everyone worshipped Elizabeth I. That's not really enough to link to the text of Shakespeare's Othello, for example. So really does need to be contextualized. That means the time that it was written needs to be very strongly linked with evidence to the play or the poem or the novel that you're writing about. Linked to this assertion argument is that of generalizations. And what happens is students lazily make assumptions about a particular idea or a particular way of thinking. So, for example, this often happens in relationship to the times of Chaucer, where people think that Chaucer just simply believed one thing or another about the Catholic Church, or people get mixed up when writing about the Renaissance in Britain and Shakespeare's contemporaries such as Marlowe and Johnson. They make assumptions that they believed completely one thing or another as Protestants, or they mix up Protestant with Catholic. So again, you need to have clear ideas about the reasons behind why something was written and the actual goings on at the time of that particular piece of writing. Next is the use of relevance. And this manifests itself in a number of ways. The first one is students just quote left, right, and centre and don't link those quotes to the text. Earlier in these videos, we saw some very interesting comments made about The Great Gatsby, and they were linked contextually to the text. So the idea of the motor car being something new in 1920s America, it wasn't just a whole blitz of quotations about motor cars. There wasn't just lots and lots of different quotations about it, not linked or explained or justified or evaluated. So students tend to use too many quotations that are around the area of the context, but don't really link to the question they're being asked. And that links again to this second point here, failure to link those points. It's very important that any quotations you use are definitely there to support or extend or help you evaluate a comment you've already made in your answer. And normally AO4 falls flat because students don't incorporate the other AOs. AO2, where we're looking at language, structure and form, and AO3, where we're looking at links, similarities between texts and differences within those similarities and similarities within those differences. So again, it's all really about background knowledge, background reading and background understanding in order to link that up within your writing. Here we have an A example of the use of AO4, and it links very much to what we've been talking about. It concerns a response to a question on Othello. Immediately we see that the student has a very good grasp of the context of the play with these two words here, Machiavellian and malcontent. Both these ideas link to certain negative characters in Elizabethan drama. There isn't a massive explanation after that. There isn't a massive quotation blitz. The terms are strongly put. And again, here we see AO1 in action. The student then goes on to justify the point they made and develop it and link it very clearly to the text and very clearly to the author's intentions. Not just let it float free and say Iago is a malcontent and then say he does bad things. This candidate digs deeper and contextualizes this comment and actually unpacks it, explains it, evaluates it, and links it to an earlier form of drama, the medieval morality play, and that Iago is mainly a link to that vice-like figure, and Othello, the innocent everyman whose common vices bring him low and make him a victim of that vice. So you can see that AO1, 2, 3, and 4 often link together. And if you look back over these videos and at the particular pieces of writing, you can see that AO1 brings those AOs 2, 3, and 4 out and make them clearer and show the candidate's strong understanding of the text on those three assessment objective levels. That's why they received the A grade. Not because they had some miraculous insight into the play, but they were able to make clear points that link together and quote or show knowledge that backed up the points they made.